Right, now's the time for the kids to come forward. Kids of all ages are invited to come up at this time. Make sure you move back a little bit because I have made a video for you guys. So make sure that you can see the screen. Make sure everybody can see the screen. Come on in and have a seat. It's so good to be together with you today. We're excited that you're here because we continue our God Questions series. And remember, the God Questions are the deep questions of the faith that we need to wrestle with as a community so that we can understand who God is and what He calls us to be. And so today is a very, very big question. It is, do all roads lead to heaven? So many of you that go to the local schools, you're going to have people in your classroom that maybe are Muslim or Hindu or Buddhist. And so you have to understand what they believe and whether or not all roads lead to the same place. And so as I was thinking about roads and a place, I was reminded of today's passage where Jesus says that He goes to prepare a royal suite for us in heaven. Now, how many of you have ever stayed in a nice hotel before? Kids, have you ever stayed in a nice hotel? How about a nice hotel that has a pool in it? How many of you ever stayed in a royal suite before? Oh, normally those are reserved for princes and princesses. And what we're going to see in today's passage is that Jesus says He goes to prepare a royal suite for all of His people. And so I was thinking about that. I've got getting a room and reservation. And so I made a video of what happened when I walked down this really long road trying to get a reservation at one of our local resorts. Would someone please get the lights for me? Maria's going to get that. Thank you so much. And watch what happens when I try to find a reservation. Just come along the way, and I'm here to check in.
Good. And what is your name, sir?
My name is George Benjamin Bowater IV.
Oh, a very powerful name. Good. Let's go check with a clerk and see if we have a reservation. Do you have a reservation for a George Benjamin Bowater IV?
I'll take a look. Sorry, I don't have a reservation under that name.
There must be some kind of mistake. I was told that the royal suite is being prepared for me.
I'm very sorry, sir. Very sorry. Did you actually pay for the reservation?
Pay? No. How much does it cost? What? There must be some kind of mistake. I can't cover this cost.
Well, I'm sorry, sir. If you can't cover the cost, we can't prepare the room for you.
All right. Well, what kind of room can I get for this amount?
I'm sorry, sir. That's still not enough.
Still not enough.
I'm very sorry, sir.
I guess I need to go then.
I'm very sorry, sir.
I'm really sorry, sir. I'm really sorry we couldn't have you here. I hope you find your way. Mm-hmm.
Oh, right, if we get the lights again. So kids, as you can see, I walked all that way and I didn't even have a reservation. How do you think I felt as that gentleman was looking through all the names and couldn't find me? Taylor, what do you think? I was very anxious. Did you see? I kept looking. Oh, man. And how do you think I felt when he couldn't find my name in the registration book? How do you think I felt? Mad. What else?
Sad.
Absolutely. Because I really wanted to stay in the royal suite. And then to find out that I didn't have enough money of what it cost, I was just so depressed. But what we're going to see in today's passage is that it's a great illustration for how Jesus is saying, look, he's going to prepare a place, a royal suite for all of his people. And he's going to tell us that the road to get there, the way to get there, is through him. And so that's what we're going to talk about today. So you guys stay there a minute. Judah, can you hold that bowl of candy for me? So you guys could grab, Manny, can you hold that one? Grab a piece of candy before you return to your seats. If you attend preschool through first grade, you can head to rest stop with your parents' permission. Everybody else, if you could open up your Bibles to the book of John. We're going to be in chapter 14 today. Good job listening, guys. I hope you liked my video. If you're a guest with us today, thanks so much for joining us. We are in the middle of our spring sermon series going through the God questions. And today's question that I tried to illustrate with the kids is, do all roads lead to heaven? And so each week we're dealing with another difficult question that people in our world wrestle with, the deep questions of the faith. And so as a guide, we are using the God Questions book by Pastor Hal Seed. Many of you know that Marie and I got to meet him a few years back at a conference in New York. And he works out in California, and he's surrounded by a very diverse population, many of whom have no Christian understanding whatsoever. And so they come to him and they ask him these deep questions of the faith, wrestling with what is true and how do we know what to believe. And so today's question, we're going to look quite a bit at what Halsey did in terms of research, looking through the do all roads lead to heaven. So in order for us to understand that question, we need to understand the different religions. And so here's a pie chart. I think this is from 2010. It was the last time I could get the statistics. But you'll notice we're not going to have time to go over all the other religions, but I do want to go over the top five religious beliefs or worldviews before we could dig into today's passage. So let's look at the top four before we read the passage. The fifth largest belief system is Buddhism. There's 488 million. It's founded by a guy named Siddhartha Gautama. His view of God really isn't stressed, but he has this means of enlightenment called the Four Noble Truths. At a certain point in his life, Siddhartha became convinced that Hinduism did not hold the secrets to a satisfying life. So he secluded himself under a fig tree for 40 days and nights, meditated on the nature of life, and while he meditated, he became enlightened. And so Buddha, which means enlightened one, what he realized under that fig tree became known as the Four Noble Truths, which are the keys to enlightenment. He said, suffering is universal, craving is the root cause of suffering, the cure for suffering is to eliminate craving, and craving is eliminated by following the Eightfold Path. Well, what's that? Having right views, right thought, right speech, right behavior, right occupation, right effort, right contemplation, and right meditation. By following the Eightfold Path, one can achieve oneness with the universe that will leave you without detachment or hindrance. So that's one. Number four, the fourth largest belief system is Hinduism. There's about 1 billion followers. It was founded over 800 years. The view of God is pantheism, which means God is in all things. Means to God is through reincarnation, and the view of the afterlife, moksha, which means release. And so Hindus believe that there is one uniform force in the universe called Brahman, and that the ultimate aim of every Hindu is to meld into the inanimate force of the universe and to be reabsorbed into the great cosmic unconsciousness. Through living well at various levels, you can eventually achieve a high caste position by being reborn into a Brahman family. A Hindu views that the ultimate afterlife destination is this moksha, which means release, where you lose all awareness and simply exist as a portion of the universe. And so Hindu scholars estimate it takes about 600,000 lifetimes in order to reach moksha. The third largest, and I would argue rapidly growing belief system, is made up of non-religious, secularists, agnostic, and atheist. Probably many of us have friends, family members, neighbors that fall into this growing category. There's about a billion of them, and so what do they believe? Many non-religious folks explain their worldview by saying that they choose not to explore faith and religion. Many would say they just don't believe in a God, in the spiritual realm, or life after death. This life is all that there is, and after we die, we stop existing. The second largest belief system is Islam. There's about 1.6 billion, founded by Muhammad. View of God is monotheistic, and the means to God is what are called the five pillars of Islam, and the view of the afterlife, something they call paradise. Muhammad taught his followers that the true and only means to Allah was through following the five pillars of Islam. Those five pillars consist of the Shahada, which is basically a creed. There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. The Salat is to pray five times a day facing the city of Mecca. Zakat, giving to the poor. Zam is fasting the daylight hours during the month of Ramadan. And finally, the Hajj, which is a pilgrimage to Mecca at least once in your lifetime. And so by practicing these five actions devoutly and religiously, you might be granted entrance into paradise. And so with those different religious views in mind, let's take a look at what Christianity has to say about the way to heaven. It will be up on the screen starting with verse 1, where Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. For I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, so that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." But Thomas said, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how could we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." Jesus answered him, saying, "Don't you know me, Philip, even after I have been along you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How could you say, 'Show us the Father'? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you are not just my own, rather it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves. For I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these because I am going to the Father, and I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. If you love me, you will obey what I command. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever. The Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you." And so in order for us to truly understand today's passage, we once again need to understand the context of these words. If you remember, Jesus' disciples had gathered in the upper room. It was time for the Passover feast. And at that Passover feast, Jesus took the time to wash his disciples' feet. He took the time to share a meal with them that we know now as the Last Supper. And as part of their supper, Jesus declared that he was about to give his life for all of us on the cross. Not only that, but he said that one of their members, one of the 12, was about to betray him. Not only that, of all people, Peter, Jesus just told him he was going to deny even knowing Jesus three times. So if you were one of those folks in that room and you were hearing all this traumatic things, you too would be upset. You too would need some comfort. And that is why Jesus begins this section by giving great comfort, saying, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me." Now, if you were one of the disciples, you'd be like, "Yeah, right. Jesus, we've been following you. We gave up everything, and now you're going to leave us? You're going to allow yourself to be crucified? Oh, I don't know about all of this." And so you're immediately filled with this anxiety, and you need help and hope for the future. And so what is that hope for the future? Verse 2, "In my Father's house are many rooms." Now, that word room there in Greek is monē. And it literally means an extravagant dwelling place. And so this is no broom closet in a Motel 6, right? No, this is a royal suite. Think of the most beautiful, well-decorated, all the amenities. There's probably a jacuzzi in there. I don't know. I'm just assuming. But imagine the most expensive hotel room in the world. That is what Jesus said he was preparing in heaven for his people. And he says, if it were not so, I would have told you. And I'm going back there to prepare that place for you. If I go and prepare that place, I'll come back to take you to be where you, so you can be where I am. And then he says, you know the way to the place that I'm going. And you can think of the disciples saying, okay, that sounds beautiful to have a royal suite in God's heavenly hotel room. Yeah, that would be great, but how do I get there? And so Thomas, one of the disciples, asks his own God question. And he says, Lord, we don't know where you're going. So how could we know the way? What was Thomas asking there? He wanted to know what road led him to the royal suite that God the Father has in his home for him. And look at how Jesus responds in verse 6. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now, what did Jesus mean there by way? John, can we please see that? The Greek word there for way is hodos. And it literally means a traveling way or a road. And I'll think back to the children's message, right? I was walking down that long wooded road with my heavy luggage, right? That's the road he's talking about. So clearly Jesus is saying only his road. Jesus is saying only his way leads us to heaven. Early Christians were actually first known as the followers of the way. They weren't known as Christians. They were just, oh, are you a follower of the way? Yet that still seems unfair to some people. But as the late R.C. Sproul explains, I really cannot think of anything more antithetical to biblical Christianity than the idea it doesn't matter what you believe. And yet it has been inculcated in us from the time that we were in kindergarten. I think it is because here in the U.S., all religions are equally tolerated under the law. So we make a gratuitous leap from equality under the law to equal validity before God. And that's a perilous place to stand, because the scriptures say that there's a difference between truth and falsehood, between true Messiah and false messiahs, and between Christ and Antichrist. And so Jesus elaborates on this and saying, no one comes to the Father, in other words, no one gets that royal suite in heaven except through me. If you really knew me, you know the Father. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. And so in this first section, we see Jesus declare who God the Son is. He is the way, the truth, and the life. And yet another disciple has another God question, more of a statement. Philip says, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough. And so you can imagine Jesus is like, are you kidding me? Have you ever told somebody something so many times that when they ask to repeat it, you're just like, my teachers know what this is. Put your hand down, son. I do it to you all the time. Here's the thing. Good old Philip says, wait a minute. Show me, just we need proof. And Jesus answers, don't you know me, Philip? Even after I've been among you for such a long time. And I wish we had more time. But in the second section, we've seen God the Son. And now in the second section, explanation of God the Father. But jump down to verse 12. I want to focus on this briefly. He says, I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. Not only that, will do even greater things, because I am going to the Father. And this is what's so strange. Jesus says, I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. That sounds like a really good deal. And this is part of the reason why when people read the Bible, they think God is like a genie in the bottle. Okay? So let's just pretend, and I've actually had people do this, not literally, but figuratively. Okay, Jesus, I would like to win the lottery. Oh, sorry. I would like to win the lottery in Jesus' name. Is that what Jesus is referring to? That anything we ask in his name, he's going to go, well, that's what he said. So what does he mean here? And this is the illustration I often use when people ask me about this. I want you to imagine in your head the most beautiful, powerful, rushing river you can ever witness. And when you come upon that river, let's say you go hiking, and you're in this beautiful part of the country, and you come across this beautiful rushing river, you have a choice to make. You can stay on the side, right? Or if you kind of dip your toe in, whoo, that's cold, right? What Christ is asking of his people is that we actually jump in. And what happens is we get swept along by his current. We get swept along by his purposes. We're not in control. He's taking us wherever he wants us to go. But how many people do we know actually do that, right? They sort of stand on the banks of the river and say, that looks dangerous. What Jesus is saying is when we are fully embracing his mission for the world and his purposes, we are swept away in such a way that the things that we pray for are already in line with his purposes, because that's where his spirit is taking us. And that is what Jesus is illustrating here. And so we've seen an illustration of God the Son, he was the way. We've seen an explanation of God the Father and how Jesus is going to be headed there. And then in the final short section, we see the promise of the Holy Spirit. He says, if you love me, you will obey what I command. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor. Now, John, if we could see that, what does Jesus mean there? The Greek word for counselor is parakletos, which refers to a divine helper, or one who pleads another's cause before a judge, a counsel for the defense, an advocate. For as the Message translation describes him as this, I love this, this friend that Jesus was referring to is the Spirit of Truth. The godless world can't take him in because it doesn't have eyes to see him, doesn't know what to look for. But you know him already because he has been staying with you and will even be in you. And so as you think back to the children's message again, John, can we see that picture? How many of you ever stayed at the Fine Oak Court Resort? Anybody? How many of you know where it is? Let's start there. Very good. Again, when I hear these ideas, I never know if they're going to turn out. And I'm so grateful to the owners of the Oak Court Resort, so that if you ever see them, tell them thank you that they opened up. Not only that, but I believe her name is Susan. She actually got into costume. Did you see that? She was so excited to help us illustrate what we did for the kids, because we all know what it's like to go on a long journey and to get to your hotel, you're exhausted, and then there's a double booking. Sorry, sir, there's no room for you here. Or worse, you get there, and even though you have, like, on your phone the reservation, they say, sorry, we have no record of you here. Right? Especially if you have, like, five or six kids. Where are they going to sleep? Right? I wanted to illustrate what it's like for all of humanity to go on this long road knowing that at the end there's something amazing, but yet if you go down the wrong road, if you don't have a reservation, the disappointment that people must feel. And so we've talked about the top four belief systems. Let's talk about the top one. Christianity. Followers, 2.2 million. And now I need to point out that sadly this number includes nominal Christians. What's a nominal Christian? This is people who see the mighty rushing river of God's purposes for their life, and they only go like this. I'm a Christian. Maybe on Sundays. Maybe when Ben and Maria are around. Right? Are they really Christians? The founder, of course, is Christ. The view of God is monotheism. But notice we talked about in today's passage, there is one God, and he exists in three persons, God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The means to God is something called substitutionary atonement. When Jesus died on the cross to pay for our sins, his last words were, it is finished. But you can also translate that Greek word as paid in full. And so, of course, the view of the afterlife is heaven. We talked about that today. But comparing the top five belief systems, let's make some observations. First, every religion claims to be the only way to God. Every religion has a different roadmap to get to heaven. And third, almost all their ideas of the afterlife are all very different. And so knowing this reality, some people may still ask, would a loving God really allow sincerely religious people all around the world to miss out on heaven? To which I would respond, how much more loving could God be than to make a way for us to get into heaven by giving up his own life for us? And so of all the religions in the world, Christianity is the only one that claims that God did the work, not us. Look at it this way. Islam, Buddhism, Hinduism, all teach that there are certain things you must do in order to obtain a version of a positive afterlife. You must practice the five pillars or the eightfold path or die and be reincarnated 600,000 times. I'm sorry, that sounds exhausting. In closing, the Christian faith teaches that there is nothing that you or I can ever do to pay the cost of reservation in heaven. Remember that video? I didn't have enough. Verses like Romans 3:23 teach all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We are broken creatures, and no matter what we do, we're going to remain broken. And since God is perfect, the only way to get into His presence is to be perfect, or for someone to pay the cost of our forgiveness. And so the Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So maybe you found this small gift box, and you're saying, well, Ben, you forgot one of your illustrations. No, I didn't. What we see in Scripture is that the gift of salvation is offered to everyone. And so, obviously, what's inside the gift of salvation box is a cross that represents the cost that it took to pay for our reservation in heaven. But this is not a gift that we should just keep to ourselves, right? This is a gift that we need to share with everyone we meet. And that leads us to our final question. And now this is one of the God questions that I had when I was in my 20s that caused me to walk away from the faith. And then, of course, is what happens to the Buddhist monk on top of that mountain in Tibet? What happens to him? And so to answer that question, I want to remind you of what happened after Jesus rose from the grave. There was one of the disciples, we met him in today's passage, named Thomas. He's known as Doubting Thomas. Why? Because he refused to believe that Jesus had actually come back from the dead until he had the proof of the hands and the sign. And when Thomas realized that Jesus had actually come back from the dead and that he had given his life on a cross so that we could have a room in heaven reserved for us, he was so changed that he traveled in 52 AD all the way from Jerusalem to India. And if you don't believe me, John, can we see it, please? There's one of the churches, now granted Thomas didn't build that, but on that location is one of the many churches that St. Thomas started because he was so moved by what he had seen. And if you doubt me still, looking at this map, that little marker on India, that is where Thomas is buried. He has a tomb there. And so you need to ask this question, what would motivate Thomas to go all the way from Jerusalem in the ancient world, all the way to the subcontinent of India? What would motivate him to do that? And so my answer to that is a verse I have up on the wall of my study. The Apostle Paul says, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord Jesus will be saved. And he asks his own God question, how then can they call on the one that they've not believed in? How can they believe in the one whom they've not heard? How can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the good feet of those who bring good news. I want everybody to look at your feet right now. Everybody, look down, look at your feet. Pastoral orders, look at your feet. And I want you to listen. Let us be the ones with beautiful feet. I don't care if you have ugly feet. Let us be the ones with beautiful feet to bring the good news of the gift of salvation to the ends of the earth. And so maybe you're here today and you're kind of feeling that tug. Maybe you're going to start by joining Team World Vision to bring water to the folks that need it. Maybe one of the kids in our church is going to be a missionary to India. We have to listen for those kingdom opportunities because we are the ones that are called to bring the gift of salvation and to tell the people of the world that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today's word. Lord, we thank you for the series that forces us to wrestle with. We have Muslim friends and we have Buddhist friends and we have Islam. It's one of those things that our country is wrestling with. How do we handle it? Yet, Lord, they each have a road. And yet we see in your word that you are the way, you are that road, and that no one comes to the Father except through you. And while that seems so harsh, while that seems so elitist, Lord, that's what you said. And so we have to deal with that. But we don't just have to deal with it, we have to understand, Lord, that you gave your life as the cost for our reservation in heaven. And so, Lord, we thank you for being the way that you made for us to be with you for all eternity. We pray this in Jesus' name.